those three nationalist pieces we just heard, two were actually written in the 20th century. So once again, we're on a cusp and moving into a new stylistic era. As a matter of fact, a number of the pieces from this point on we could really consider, particularly if they're French, impressionist, or on the German side, post-impressionist. But there's more of that to come. In this case, coming up, we're dealing with another Italian, and Puccini is really the culmination in some ways of that great operatic tradition that starts back at least with Rossini, continuing with Bellini and Donizetti to the great Verdi, who was probably at the top of the echelon, and Puccini as the second greatest of the Italian opera composers. He does through composition, he's got some Wagnerian leitmotifs going through, and here's the story, boy meets girl. Girl is a poor seamstress. Boy is in a home share, apartment, attic share situation. The Bohemians. These are not people from Czechoslovakia, but just the artistes in a Parisian garret. And in some ways, because this is an Italian opera composed, of course, they're all speaking, singing French. This is another example of exoticism, by golly. At any rate, the boys come into some money. Colleen, the musician, has made some sort of contractual arrangement to play his French horn for a rich patron until that patron's parrot dies. Of course, he poisons the parrot, so they get their money right away. They've come into this money Christmas Eve. They're going to go out partying. And the poet, our hero, Rodolfo, lingers in the studio. The poor seamstress appears. Her candle goes out as she's trying to find her key, and love at first sight. I've seen this done recently in an updated version, and the cell phone power goes out. At any rate, amor, amor, and you get at the end the soprano rising, a minor third, la do, and the tenor, fa mi, which is a wonderful holy plagal cadence. Quite lovely. And then the beginning of Act Two, and our through line is fragments of Act Two, and hopefully on your own you'll have a chance to listen to the whole glorious act. It is entirely a rondo. This is pretty typical of large-scale operatic, grand opera, choral scenes. The rondo theme can really provide some glue. And check this rondo theme out. I'm just transposing it to C major because it's easier on the piano. Here it goes. That's all parallel harmony. We have not heard that since medieval times. Wow. But we'll hear it a lot more in the 20th century. Check back with Debussy and Stravinsky, among others. So that is the repeated theme that comes back. It comes back in very varied ways. Other light motifs bounce around. The Mimi, the poor seamstress, is introduced to the boys, including Marcello, the painter, and Schaunard, the philosopher. And mid-scene, suddenly, who shows up but Musetta, former flame of Marcello. She's got a sugar daddy, and how about that? This is actually the second old clueless guy in the opera. It's a tradition known as basso buffo. Goes back certainly to Rossini and even to a guy we didn't mention, Pergolesi, a transition character between the late Baroque and the classical era. At any rate, Mimi, Musetta, sings her famous waltz, which is quite rubato, as the wonderful chords we get, which we have not heard much of. This one, major seventh chord, major triad, and major seventh interval. And while it's hardly the first usage, composers stumble upon it every once in a while, and arguably maybe Puccini is doing likewise, but about a decade before, maybe 8 years before, Satie makes that a very prominent part of his Gymnopédie number one, which is coming along yet. And then after that, a chord of the added sixth, do, mi, so, la. But if you put that la down an octave, it's actually a first inversion minor seventh chord. And these aversions, of course, course, go all the way back, at least in versions of triads, to the Renaissance, where we're in solid ground. At any rate, we better finish this up. In the course of Musetta's waltz, rubato, very languorous in its robbing of time, Marcello, his heart, shall we say, is recaptured. He falls back in love with Musetta, and they figure out a way to dump the old guy. She fakes a foot injury. He's sent off to the apothecary, and the bill arrives, and they can't pay it. What are they going to do? So Musetta is at the fore. She says to the waiter, put these two bills together. My paramour will pay it when he gets back. How to escape? Conveniently enough, a marching band. The banda appears on stage, and the soldiers marching across give our heroes and heroines a method of escape at the end of the act. Huzzah!
Al ritorno
curioso,
dammi il braccio mia piccina,
oh benissimo signor,
e mami di
mia tua.
Legatevi alla seggiola, quella gente che vi ha.
Thank you.
Io presto